Vegas na, these are the important points. You can take a screenshot if you want, and these are the basic things. Okay, these are the basic things, and this slide is important for MCQ part. Okay, so two ganglia, always remember, superior ganglia is rounded and lies in the jugular foramen, and infraganglia is cylindrical, lies near the base of the skull. And as you know, the vagus nerve passes to which foramen? Murli, it passes to which foramen? Vagus nerve from base of the skull?
Jugular foramen.
Jugular foramen, along with cranial nerve number 9 and 11. Okay, so that's how you get the ganglia as well. Okay, now come to the next slide. Oh, sorry. So here in this picture, you can see it is coming from the brain, and mostly it will be arising from the medulla. Okay, medulla, then you'll be supplying the pharynx, larynx. Okay, when you learn the larynx classes, you must have already heard the vagus nerve multiple times. Then it is supplying the lungs, it is supplying the heart. Okay, it will be also supplying esophagus, trachea, everything, whatever is present here. Okay, then coming down, it will be supplying the abdominal structures like this. Okay, the branches at the end, I'll be telling you. So if you see here, this is the medulla oblongata area. This is pons actually. Today, whoever came to dissection hall, and yesterday also, you have already seen the different parts of the brain and how the attachment already, I had shown the dural folds and venous sinuses also. Whoever didn't come, will show you later. Now you can see here, through this jugular foramen, this cranial root of accessory will be accompanying the vagus. You can see, and this vagus will have these two ganglia, superior ganglion and infraganglion. Okay, so what happens, I don't want to talk about all this now. These vagus nerve, they will come out as rootlets, 10 rootlets. Okay, so the most important part is the functional component of the vagus. This part, again, in details you learn in physiology. So just this chart, I want everybody to take a screenshot here. Why? Because this will help you immensely. If you know this chart and if you can draw and practice once, you can attempt any questions, even later on. Okay. So now, see the chart properly and I'll be telling you. Now, these are all small, small letters because we haven't taught you brain. Now, that's why this chart I want to tell you. So this midbrain, pons and medulla. So what you have to know, that most of the nucleus present for vagus is in the medulla. Okay, all the nuclei. And what are the nuclei important for vagus nerve? Dorsal nucleus of vagus, nucleus ambiguus, nucleus of solitary tract, and spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. It's a little covered. Just pull it. Okay. So, spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. Now, all these nucleus, they will give separate, special fibers will be there. And what are the fibers? You already know a nerve, it will have a motor root and a sensory root. If it is a mix, it is a both. Okay, if it is a sensory, only central. So in vagus, what we can see, GVE means general visceral efferent, special visceral efferent, general somatic efferent, and special visceral efferent, and general visceral efferent. Now already you learned larynx. Okay, you have already come to know that larynx is supplied by the vagus, isn't it? So superior laryngeal, then dividing into external laryngeal and internal laryngeal, then recurrent laryngeal. You have already learned about that. At the end, I'll be telling about the branches. But here, what I want to say about the all this efferents and efferents, how it is. This is called functional component of the vagus nerve. Okay. So smooth muscle and the glands of the thoracic and abdominal viscera will be. What is this? Can anybody tell me what is this letter says? I think I took you.
Ganglion.
Yes, this is the ganglion. So that means preganglionic is coming and postganglion is starting from here. So smooth muscles and glands in the thoracic and abdominal viscera will be related by the GVE. GVE is related to which nucleus? Dorsal nucleus of vagus. Then muscles of larynx and pharynx. Okay, that is special visceral efferent. All the muscles of will be supplied by this. Now, superior laryngeal will be supplying the cricothyroid muscle. I think you already know that, isn't it? Cricothyroid is supplied by the superior laryngeal muscle, but all the muscles of the vocal cord are supplied by recurrent laryngeal muscle. Do you know that? And the mucous membrane of the vocal cord is supplied by the internal laryngeal. So here what we have, muscles of the larynx and pharynx, both are special visceral efferent. They are related to which nucleus? Nucleus ambiguous. Today you just know the names, okay? You don't need to go into details. Later on in brain time, that time again we'll be speaking to you. Then skin of the ear, this one. Because one branch comes to the ear from vagus, that is superior ganglion and related to the trigeminal. Trigeminal actually ganglion, this one will have a link in the midbrain, pons and medulla. It's a huge a nucleus. Okay, so then last, this one I want to say is test from the epiglottis and posteriormost part of the tongue. Already I told you in the tongue class, posteriormost part of the tongue as well as epiglottis is supplied by superior laryngeal nerve. We have already learned the pharyngeal arches, no, nerve supply. So it is developed from fourth arch. That's why it is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve. So that comes under this one and this one. Now, general visceral efferent, general sensations from thoracic and abdominal viscera. So all these ultimately is coming to the solitary tract. This I have explained to you. Now, step by step, I'll be explaining in details. Okay. So these functional components, whatever I had shown, now with theory I'll show. So, special visceral efferent, that is the fibers are processes of neurons of nucleus ambiguous, that is actually the branchiomotor nucleus present in medulla and supplies muscles of the pharynx and larynx. You just remember vagus nerves comes out of medulla. So, all the nuclei, whatever I'm going to talk now or whatever I said just now, are all from the medulla. They are all located in medulla. And beautiful diagram is there, you'll understand very clearly. Then next is the general visceral efferent. Do you notice first special, then now general? What is visceral efferent means? Motor nerves. Okay. So these general visceral efferent, they are in the dorsal nucleus of vagus and they are visceromotor and secretomotor. That means what? They will supply the viscera, they will supply the glands, secretomotor. Or if you can't remember anything, simply you remember this is the motor. Okay. Dorsal nucleus of vagus is a motor. It will give the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers and distribute it to thoracic and abdominal viscera. You understand now? What are the thoracic viscera? All these lungs and heart and esophagus, trachea, all those. Okay, abdominal, liver, gallbladder, then stomach, small intestine, even 2/3 of the large intestine. So all those, okay? Besides that, so many glands are there. They also will be supplied. Then coming general visceral efferent. General visceral efferent, fibers are peripheral processes of neurons located in the inferior ganglion of the nerve. Now it is the infraganglion which has come into play. Okay, so these efferents from here, these are efferents. What we finished is the two efferents. You remember? So both the efferents, one will be general, one will be special. Now I'm talking about what? General visceral efferent, that means sensory. So, fibers are peripheral processes of neurons located in the infraganglion of the nerve and efferents from pharynx, larynx, trachea, esophagus, thoracic, abdominal viscera. That means anni, everything, all, that's why it is the vagus nerve, vague, everything, actually father figure, you can say Bhishma, whatever you want to give names, okay? So, it will help everything to function, it will help everything to take care of, all the autonomic nerves, that is sympathetic, parasympathetic, mainly the parasympathetic, all will be supplied through vagus. Okay. So these general visceral efferent, they are conveyed by central processes of ganglion cells to the nucleus of solitary tract. All these names you have heard today for the first time, I guess. So it is little foreign to you today, but today you just know the names. And later on in brain class, you'll know in details, okay? So now I finished with general visceral efferent. Now special visceral efferent. These are important. Why? Because this is mainly related to the test, okay? So I told you when I took the class, you remember, I hope you, Priti Sharma, can you tell what is the anterior two third of tongue sensation, taste sensation by?
Lingual, ma'am. Lingual.
Lingual, na? Actually, it is corda tympani, which will come to the lingual.
Taste is by
branch of facial, but it will come to lingual nerve. Then posterior one third by Sai Krishna.
Glossopharyngeal.
Then posterior most by vagus nerve. That is that's why. Facial, visceral, efferent. Why facial? Because sensation. Taste sensation. Okay. Visceral means it is the tongue. Efferent means it is taking the sensory. So, and posterior most part of tongue, including the epiglottis, is developed from fourth arch. That's why it is supplied by superior laryngeal. Okay. And vocal cord onwards down, it is by sixth arch. That is the nerve of the sixth arch is recurrent laryngeal. So, it will go by recurrent laryngeal. Now, this facial visceral efferent also, it will be going to the nucleus of salutary tract. So, all the visceral efferent, whether general or special, it will be related to the nucleus of salutary tract. So, how many nucleus you learned till now? Three. Okay. Ambiguous, dorsal nucleus of vagus and nucleus of salutary tract. Now, this is the last one. So, how many functional component I told you? Five. Okay. General, visceral, efferent, special visceral efferent, general visceral efferent, special visceral efferent. And this is general somatic afferent. Somatic means body. Okay. Fibers of the peripheral processes of neurons in the superior ganglion and are distributed in of the external ear. This one. Okay. How it happens in the applied, you learn very nicely. It's very interesting actually. The central processes of the ganglion cells terminate in spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. This is the last one. Okay. So, four nuclei basically, ambiguous, dorsal nucleus of vagus, then nucleus of solitary tract and spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. Okay. So, you may be saying how trigeminal nerve is there, but the nucleus is very big. I told you it will extend the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. It will extend from midbrain, pons and medulla. And the medulla part will help in the formation of vagus nerve. Okay. So these are the nuclei. Another diagram is there which I'll show you details. So these are the nucleus. All of them will come and form together. Okay. And they will form the superior ganglion. Here is the inferior ganglion. Okay. Then this one branch is coming to the ear. Then one branch you can see it is going to the tongue. Okay. Soft palate. These are the pharynx. Okay. Pharyngeal muscles. Pharynx class is actually tomorrow. And that has been cancelled because tomorrow exam is there. I'll tell you about that later. Then you can see it is also coming to the arteries and one nerve going down to the thorax and abdomen. So let's see. Now this is the lovely diagram. You can actually take a screenshot because multiple diagrams I have seen in the book also, but I didn't like it. This is a diagram and multiple different colors are there. So what happens? These are the nucleus. Okay, dorsal nucleus of vagus, then nucleus ambiguous, nucleus, spinal nucleus of fifth nerve, trigeminal and nucleus solitarius. These four nucleus fibers will come out and they will come out between this olivary nucleus, infraolivary nucleus and the inferior cerebellar peduncle. I think you already know what is inferior cerebellar peduncle. There are three peduncles, that means which the cerebellum is connected to the midbrain, pons and medulla. So, the which connects to the medulla is called inferior cerebellar peduncle. So, it will come between these two. There is a small groove in the medulla. Once exam is over, when you come to the dissection hall, I'll show you this area. Okay? You just remind me because many things will be in the head. Once one of you, anybody in your own group, one guy, Badri from roll number 7, you remind me from first group, from second group, whom? Roll number 97. Okay. And third group, Sai Krishna. Okay. Okay. All are sleeping.
Okay.
So, then I'll show you the group, how it comes out. Okay. So, then they will form one big nerve, that is the vagus nerve. So, course and distribution, As I showed you, vagus nerve fibers run forwards and laterally in the reticular formation of the medulla. So this actually, one thing I forgot to show in the diagram. So here you have the all this pyramid, all this not required. Okay. So here this area is called the reticular formation. So you might think, what is reticular formation? All the fibers, they'll crisscross and they will. Hey, doorja ko mona ho jaise. So it emerges as a series of about 10 rootlets. This is the interesting part, which I want to show you in the dissection hall. That day I have cut and taken out the medulla. Today, whoever has seen yesterday also, 10 rootlets about. It will come as a rootlets. Okay. Then they will all connect and they will form one nerve. Okay. And that rootlets are found between the olive body nucleus and the infracerebellar peduncle, as I showed you just now. It traverses the posterior cranial fossa, passing laterally along the jugular tubercle, along with the cranial nerve number 9 and 11. I showed you that already. So yesterday when I was taking out the brain, so part by part, I hope you had already seen the video. So first I removed the cerebrum. Till that time, I cut only up to the number 7. So to cut the cerebellum out along with the pons and medulla, I had to cut cranial nerve number 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 9, 10, 11 was where? In jugular foramen. Then I had to cut the hypoglossal nerve at the condylar foramen. Isn't it? So, as I told you, and you all already know, multiple times it has been said, this nerve will come out of the jugular foramen. Can anybody tell me what is the other content of jugular foramen? Manideep? Or anybody? Who can tell
me? Internal jugular vein.
Internal jugular vein. Very good. Internal jugular vein will start at the jugular foramen as the continuation of the sigmoid sinus, isn't it? So, and there are some other small emissary veins you don't need now. Okay. The superior sensory ganglion of the nerve is located in the jugular foramen. Okay. So, here you can see same thing, same diagram. So, here is the jugular foramen that will come out of this, and then it will all the functional components, 5 functional components, accordingly, it will go to different areas. Okay. And one functional component was the last one, which I told you, general somatic afferent will come to the ear. Okay. And all this like this, it will go and supply. So in the course, it has an extracranial course and it has an intracranial course. Okay. Intracranial part already I told you. That means from the medulla up to the jugular foramen, it is the intracranial course. Okay. Now, once it comes out of the jugular foramen, what happens is the extracranial course. So the infraganglion of the vagus lies just below the jugular foramen or at the base of the skull. Okay. Below the infraganglion, the cranial root of the accessory nerve joins the vagus nerve to be distributed along the pharyngeal and laryngeal branches. Actually, they form a plexus around the internal carotid artery. Okay. So in the neck, the vagus nerve lies within the carotid sheath along with the internal jugular vein and common carotid artery. Shriya Reddy, can you tell me the relation in the carotid sheath, vagus nerve? Already Kishan sir told you. What is the relation of vagus nerve with internal jugular vein and common carotid artery within the carotid sheath? Anybody?
Nerve vein artery.
Both the vein and artery will be in front and vagus nerve will be exactly behind, in the middle. Okay? Exactly behind. One model is there. I forgot to keep it outside. It is in the of deep cervical fascia with the carotid triangle, carotid sheath, everything. I'll put it out on Thursday. You whenever come to the section hall, you see it. Okay? You'll see the ansa cervicalis, everything. This carotid sheath is very, very important. You cannot do without studying carotid sheath. Can you hear me? And whoever is present today in the class will do very well in tomorrow's exam. So this is what? Okay, this is a common keratin and dividing into external and internal, vagus nerve will be related to it. Okay. Now coming to right vagus and left vagus, this diagram which is showing you the right vagus and left vagus nerve. So you can see here the they are showing the ganglion as well. So what is this? Trachea. What is this? Larynx. Okay. Then whole heart with the vessels. Then lungs. You can see now everything is supplied by this. So nodose ganglion. This is what I wanted to tell you. This infraganglion is also called as nodose ganglion. Okay. So this is the pharyngeal branch, superior laryngeal branch. You can see the diagram, and with the diagram, I'll be putting the theory. So the right vagus nerve possesses posterior to the root of the right lung and contributes to the pulmonary plexus. Then it runs on the posterior surface of the esophagus. You can see here very nicely. Posterior surface of the esophagus and thus contributing to the esophageal plexus. So how many plexus till now? Pulmonary plexus and esophageal plexus. That means everything it will support. Then next it enters the abdomen by passing through the esophageal opening in the diaphragm. So when the diaphragm class was taken, you had learned about the openings there, and the esophageal opening, it will along with the esophagus, the vagus nerve will enter the abdomen. Okay, so here is the lung, here is the liver and stomach. So you can imagine that here is the diaphragm. Okay, and it is coming. This vagus nerve is coming along with the esophagus. Okay, when it's coming along with the esophagus, it will, with the celiac plexus, it will make, it will supply the stomach and other things, which I'll show you in the next slide. So this is another diagram, same only. You can see here simple diagram. Here you can see how it is making a plexus over the stomach. So supplies the stomach, then duodenum, liver, kidney, small intestine and large intestine up to the junction of the proximal 2/3 and distal 1/3 of the transverse colon. That means up to here. Okay? Up to here. Okay? So this here, up to this, that means everything, almost everything is supplied by the vagus. This wide distribution in the abdomen via cilia, superior mesenteric and renal plexus. So this is renal plexus, which is supplying the kidneys, and this is the spleen. Okay, then after that, celiac means what I want to tell you is that celiac artery. I think you already know abdominal aorta. Okay, we haven't taught you abdominal aorta. No? Descending aorta, you have learned. Descending aorta will continue as abdominal aorta. There are three main branches which comes from the anterior aspect. Okay, midline branches. Celiac artery, superior mesenteric artery, and inframesenteric artery. And they will supply various parts of the foregut, midgut, and hindgut. That will be taught to you in abdomen part. So these names, celiac means you remember as stomach and the first part of the duodenum. These areas will be studied. Then superior mesenteric means you remember as small intestine, okay, and part of the large intestine. So these are some names which you will repeatedly hear in abdomen class. Today you just know the names. Am I okay? So right vagus, I think left vagus also almost same. You can see here with this diagram, same diagram I have put. So it enters the thorax, contributes to the pulmonary and esophageal plexus, same thing. Then it enters the abdomen. It will also enter to the same opening. Then supplies the stomach, liver, duodenum, head of the pancreas. Okay. These, today I want to say, actually, I also have a very old video in YouTube, rotation of gut. There, before that also, we have said this whole development of abdominal gut system. Okay. When it is developing, no? Stomach, then duodenum, small intestine, large intestine, all these, they are carrying the vagus nerve along. Okay, so this right vagus, left vagus orientation, that you'll know even better too. Okay, today I'm just telling you the branches. Later on, you'll understand why it is called right vagus, why it is called left vagus. Okay, and what, who, like stomach in details today, I'm not saying which part of stomach is supplied by right, which is by left. All these you'll learn in details later on. Okay. So what do you think? What are the branches? Same branches. Do you notice that? So either it is right vagus or left vagus. Only in the surfaces it will change here. But ultimately it is supplying the esophagus. It is supplying the larynx. It is supplying the trachea. It is supplying lungs, heart. Okay. Then it is entering through esophageal opening and supplying the abdominal viscera up to what? Junction of proximal 2/3 and distal 1/3 of large intestine. So this is a diagram in the very beginning. You can see the glossopharyngeal and the accessory is coming along with the vagus. You can take a screenshot, please. This is not present in the book. I took it from net. Please, all of you, take a screenshot of this diagram because it will help you. If glossopharyngeal nerve comes or accessory nerve comes, that time also you can present this diagram. Okay. So these are the two ganglion here you can see, and these are the communications. This is something important. It is connected to the facial and the sympathetic. So you can see pharyngeal branches, laryngeal branches, and all these others. So in a nutshell, you can see this, you can keep a screenshot. So that, why I'm saying, you know, screenshot, because what I have noticed, no matter how much I speak or other teachers speak, you go back to your textbook, you should study textbook. But sometimes too many things are there. That day one girl was asking me something related to parotid. Itna bhi zarurat nahi hai aap log ke liye. Okay, especially that Vishram Singh, extraordinary is there, not required. So yes, screenshot le lo. If you remember this much also, you can explain. Okay. So number one, auricular, it will supply the skin. Rakesh, please mute yourself. So auricular will supply the skin of the external acoustic meatus. That means you do like this, no? When you do like this, you feel good here. I told you why you feel good. All auditory nasopharynx, all those, and all sort of things you'll understand slowly, slowly. So pharynx now, muscle of the pharynx. Pharynx class was actually tomorrow. That has been postponed, and next because of exam. Superior laryngeal will be dividing into external laryngeal and internal laryngeal. And external laryngeal will supply cricothyroid, internal laryngeal, mucosa of the larynx and supraglottic part. Okay. Then cardiac, you already know, it will supply the heart. Okay. Recurrent laryngeal, muscles of the larynx except the cricothyroid and mucosa of the larynx. Why? And the infraglottic part. Because cricothyroid is supplied by what? External laryngeal branch of superior laryngeal. Why all these things are happening? Because superior laryngeal is from 4th arch, recurrent laryngeal is from the 6th arch. So according to the development, whatever is the that much. Okay. Suppose you forgot in exam which part. At least you write vagus and come. Do you understand me? Adhamainda, if you write, then nobody is giving half of it becomes one. Okay. So instead, suppose in exam suddenly you got confused which part, superior laryngeal or external, blah blah, bhul gaya sab kuch. So at least you write branch of a vagus, a branch of vagus. At least you will get half mark, and that half will become one also, you know, and the you'll pass. So if you remember well and good, in case you forget. So pulmonary, it will supply the lungs. Esophageal branches will supply the esophagus, and gastric branches, stomach, liver. That means once it goes down, gastric branches. Actually, whole development, right, left, all that we'll be learning later. So, gastric branches will supply stomach, liver, gallbladder, pancreas. So, pancreas is a gland, isn't it? So, secretomotor fibers, already I told you. Small intestine, all the functions, all the glands will be there. Large intestine, and only up to the right 2/3 of transverse colon. Okay. I want to say something here. My physiology viva. I was the last one in the viva table. Today I want to share my experience. So what happened? So many things were asked. Already whole day waiting. My brain became khali. Okay. It became empty. So I was answering, I don't know, so many things. Then my last question was, what is the nerve supply of stomach? Okay, what is the nerve supply of stomach, Kriti Sharma? Vagus nerve. So I said vagus nerve, then my teacher told go. And somehow I passed. So vagus nerve is very dear to me because it made me pass my physiology exam. Okay? So, and it is actually very important physiologically also. So that's what I wanted to share with you all. So this is another chart. Why I brought, because fourth arch, sixth arch is written. You can take a screenshot. I don't want to go into detail explaining about it. But the best part I liked here is that different colors are used. Different colors are used and you can accordingly mention. You have taken? Can I go to next slide?
Yes.
So silent. You are scared or what? Exam is nothing. There's more, you should become expert. So this is the last and the most beautiful part of today's class. I'll be explaining a lot of clinics here with respect to why vagus nerve is important. So suppose one person has come with some complaint to OPD, okay? And after inspecting, how will you come to know? Yes, yeah. Sai Kumar. Okay. So a person is coming to the OPD and he has a vagus nerve problem. How will you know? How will you know that person is actually suffering from either right side or left side or both the vagal problem is there? First thing what you do is the test it by comparing the palatal arches bilaterally. So suppose now I open my mouth. Then what we say, we usually to see the tonsil or posterior part of the tongue, usually we take out the tongue and we ask them to say ah. When you say ah, what happens? Your pharynx, the palate goes high, isn't it? The pharynx will be clear, isn't it? There is an arch. You already, I have shown in the dissection hall, palatoglossal arch and palatopharyngeal arch. You remember that? So there is an arch here and from that the palatal arches will be there and uvula will be hanging, isn't it? Everybody has seen. And your own self also you can see in the mirror. So that arch will be defective. Okay, if right-sided vagus is gone, that means arch will be defective accordingly. The normal side will be pulling it. So the most importantly, what will happen, you know, there is no arching on the paralyzed side. And uvula will be pulled to the normal side, okay? So there are some pictures in the, I have seen in the Chaurasia book. You can check in your book here. And some more things what you have is that suppose the nerve is paralyzed, what will happen, you know, nasal regurgitation of the swallowed liquid. Suppose you are drinking some water. Excuse me. So nasal regurgitation of swallowed liquid, that means when you are drinking something, normally little bit of sometimes like this like throat thing, but there will be more of nasal tone in that. Okay, and it will come towards the nose. Normally it goes to the esophagus, isn't it? But it will try to, because the palate muscles are supplied by vagus, actually through accessory. Accessory supplies the palatal muscle. So, but all this accessory, already you learned that the supply of the accessory helps with the help of the vagus. So, all these things will happen, what I have written now. Nasal twang of the voice, okay? Because pharynx is supplied by vagus, larynx is supplied by vagus, okay? So, nasal twang will be there, like this little nasal, okay? Hoarseness of voice. Now, hoarseness of voice, why? Can anybody tell me why hoarseness of voice?
Because larynx is supplied by vagus.
Because the vocal cords, the muscles of the vocal cords are supplied by recurrent laryngeal, and that is maybe injured or sometimes even compression if there is a tumor affecting the nerve, okay, pressing the nerve. So in that area, okay, some cancer in the esophagus, all this also will have problem. Then flattening of the palatal arch, already I told you. So normally palatal arch will be pulled by the palatal muscle, but that is not happening because of the paralysis of the nerve. Okay, cadaveric position of the vocal cord. Now what is cadaveric position of the vocal cord? Both the vocal cord, normally it will be like this. There is a gap in the rima glottis system. Okay, I think you already learned all this in larynx class. So if it is paralyzed, that means it will be lying like this. So that is called cadaveric position. That means in dead body, how it will be. Okay, so it will not be pulled like that. It will be like this. If it is one side, that means one side will be straight, one side will be like this. If both are paralyzed, it will be like this, side by side. Like. Okay, cadaveric position of the vocal cord. Dysphagia means difficulty in swallowing. Why? Because esophagus is also supplied by the esophageal plexus of the vagus. Okay, so this is in a nutshell, but one by one, some more things are there, we'll be seeing now. This is very interesting now. Some small children, they will have wax. Wax, you know, the ear. Even when you were small, your mom, mother or father is to put some wax seal and all that, take it out. Okay. So sometimes what happens, as you know, the auricular branch of the vagus is supplying the ear. Okay. External ear. Which part? This one. So they may reflexly cause persistent cough, vomiting, and even if it is too much, it might go to cardiac arrest in some men, some people. Okay. So wax is there. While taking out, suppose the nerve got very badly irritated, or syringing, you know what, sometimes to clean, if it is too hard, the wax is too tight, it cannot be taken out with a spatula. So what these ENT people will do, they'll put some fluid there, it will come out with the fluid. So while doing that, if the nerve is weak and it is irritated to so much that it might cause persistent cough, especially in children, you get that. And even in adults, vomiting, and sometimes if it is too much, then it will go to cardiac arrest. Why? Because ultimately it is vagus nerve. Vagus nerve is also giving branch to the heart. Okay? So communication is there, isn't it? So now, what is the last point? It is the stimulation of the same branch may reflexly produce the appetite. This is in a good sense. So suppose one person is not feeling hungry, some mentally disturbed and all that, slowly stimulation. I'm not talking about irritation. Two words are there. Irritation and this is stimulation. Slightly stimulation kare to, that person will have nice appetite. Okay. But not always it is there. So irritation of the recurrent laryngeal branch by enlarged lymph node in children may cause persistent cough. Enlarged lymph node in children, you know what? Below 6 years or below up to 5 years, adenoid bolsa. I don't know if anybody of you had experience. Exactly in the middle, in the from the heart palate area, you get a small lymph node, adenoid bolsa. Okay, later on you'll learn in details in INT when you'll have in part one. So that adenoid or other lymph nodes here, tonsillitis will be there. So in that area, if recurrent laryngeal branch is pressed, okay, then it will be irritated. Then what will happen? That for a small kid will have persistent cough. Okay, persistent cough. Then one more important thing, what I want to tell you, you have heard about geniculate ganglion. Geniculate ganglion, sometimes there is a disease called herpes zoster. This it's a viral disease. Herpes zoster is an infection. When this normally it will infect the nerve ganglion or sometimes the nerve areas, terribly painful, and usually the vesicles will come. Just like now many of you have experienced this bite, na insect bite, insect purugu, pratima purugu. So like that blisters will come, but that is different. Usually it is seen over the thorax and backside, but sometimes it will infect the geniculate ganglion. What will happen? These vesicles will appear here in front of the ear. Now, why it happens? If fibers of the facial nerve enters the vagus nerve through communication. So sometimes these areas, they are coming out together, no? So normally geniculate ganglion is related to facial nerve, okay? You might be thinking why madam is talking about geniculate. Geniculate ganglion is related to facial nerve. So in the very beginning, you remember that my first slide today. My first slide, what I showed you was the facial nerve and vagus nerve. So that time I said something I want to speak in the clinic. So these geniculate ganglion is related to facial nerve, but sometimes they will have communication with the vagus. So because of this communication, if geniculate ganglion is infected by herpes zoster, that means because a branch of vagus comes to the external auricle, you will have dystocia in this area. Okay, and it's terribly painful. Any part, even if it is thorax or not. So this already I told you, but still. So lesion of superior laryngeal nerve produces anesthesia in upper part of the larynx and paralysis of the picothyroid muscle. And here, in this case, voice will be weak and gets tired easily. Okay. So as you know, superior laryngeal will be supplying which muscle? Picothyroid muscle, isn't it? And the mucosa of the vocal cord will be supplied by the internal laryngeal, that is a branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. Now, injury of both the vocal cords or any of the vocal cords, okay, recurrent laryngeal nerve, the muscles will be supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve. So it will result in aphonia and inspiratory stridor. That means there will be vibration like this. Whenever this is inspiration, no? So there will be vibration, okay? And this usually results due to thyroidectomy. That means thyroid gland is there, no? You have already learned thyroid. I guess sir also told you that time what are the complications in thyroidectomy. So when thyroid gland has been operated, normally vagus nerve is very much related to the gland. So in that case, recurrent laryngeal nerve may be injured. Which artery, can anybody tell me which artery is related to recurrent laryngeal nerve that supplies the thyroid gland? Anybody? Any of the students?
Inferior thyroid artery.
Yes, very good. Inferior thyroid artery. Okay. So inferior thyroid artery is related to recurrent laryngeal, and superior thyroid artery is related to superior laryngeal nerve. Superior thyroid. So tying of the artery happens in the upper pole close to the vessel, and tying of the artery in the lower pole is away from the vessel. Why away? So that you do not injure the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Okay, so this is the most important part of operation of thyroidectomy, because in case this recurrent laryngeal is cut either from any of the side or injured, then what will happen? The person will not be able to talk after the thyroidectomy, and the doctor will go to jail. Okay. Okay. So you have to be very, very careful. So a surgeon is not complete unless and until he has a very good knowledge of anatomy. Let it be any surgeon. And as I told you, my last question in physiology was what? Nerve supply of stomach. That is the vagus nerve. So what is this? What is peptic ulcer? Can anybody tell me what? Do you understand what is peptic ulcer? So when stomach, there is ulcer in the stomach as well as first part of the duodenum, that is called peptic ulcer. Gastric ulcer means only stomach. Duodenal ulcer means only duodenum. Peptic ulcer means both stomach and first part of duodenum. Case, like normally if you have gastritis, you give Dizin gel, then pantoprazole, all this you give. Then if it is Helicobacter pylori infection is there. Why I'm saying all this? Because someone might have already experienced this, if not for personally your relatives or parents. So they will give accordingly that tablet. But sab kuch ho gaya. Everything is over. Nothing is being treating the person. Then what they will do, if the ulcer is continuing, then they'll go for vagotomy. Okay? Now vagotomy means total whole nerve they will not cut. It is usually called selective vagotomy. That means they will only cut that small fiber which is supplying in that area. Okay? Okay, it's a very interesting. When you learn stomach, whoever takes stomach class later on, they will tell you about this area. So that day you remember me again. So just once, I just want to revise this class. Okay, so just last once, just the clinics part I wanted to revise actually, and I wanted to show this slide, revise the applied part, because this is the only thing which I am teaching this class today mainly. So I told you about this most important part, you remember, is that the uvula will be pulled towards the normal side, because I want all of you to become very good doctors, very good clinicians, so that you can heal patients with real care. Don't run for money. Money will automatically come to you if you are good doctors. So what are the signs that you will get? Nasal regurgitation of swallowed liquid. Absence of voice. Mubina, please mute yourself. Mubina, please mute yourself. Flattening of palatal arch, cadaveric position of the vocal cord and dysphagia. Okay. Then I told you about this irritation of the auricular nerve in wax and during syringing, producing cough, vomiting, and even cardiac arrest. Then stimulation of the same nerve, but in case may produce appetite in people who has sometimes because of depression or because of post-operative, sometimes you are not feeling like eating and all different problems. Then next, I told you about recurrent laryngeal nerve irritation producing persistent cough in children, herpes zoster because of communication of facial nerve fibers to the vagus. Then I told you about injury of or lesion of superior laryngeal nerve producing anesthesia in the upper part of the larynx and paralysis of the thyroid membrane muscle. Then vocal cord paralysis because of paralysis of the recurrent laryngeal nerve. It may be both the sides or single side because of thyroidectomy operation. And last, I told you about vagotomy operation, that is mostly selective vagotomy done in peptic ulcer. Okay, so this brings to the end of my class today. Mm-hmm. So very beginning, this slide I want you all to remember. Okay, I want you all to remember this slide. What are the nerves, nucleus? Can you tell me along with me? Just 2 minutes, we'll revise and we'll finish it up. So four nucleus, nucleus ambiguous, spinal nucleus of cranial nerve 5, nucleus solitarius, dorsal motor, vagal nucleus. This motor may be secretor motor or just motor. Okay. So why I'm saying, you know, because this time, this recent final exam, first MBBS exam record batch, they have been asking nucleus. They're asking nucleus. So that's why especially I brought this slide today so that I can tell you. So after that, these all the nerves, they will come out between the olivary nucleus and the inferior cerebellar peduncle, and from a huge nerve and has two ganglions, superior ganglion and inferior ganglion. It will come out from the jugular foramen. And why it is called vagus nerve? Can anybody tell me?
Because it is distributed to all the parts.
Vague distribution in head and neck, thorax, and abdomen up to the junction of large intestine, proximal 2/3 and distal 1/3, up to that level. So the, almost everything and everything. Okay. And then all the functional components. How many functional components I told you today?
Five.
Five functional components.
Very good. So this chart, which was the first chart I had told you. So this chart, please remember. So five functional components, but four nucleus. Okay, four nucleus. This nucleus of solitary tract is important for both special visceral afferent and this one, general visual elephant. Okay, so ultimately five functional components, and this taste sensation because of that special efferent, so all the visual efferent. So this chart is important. So these nucleus, I told you the chart, you remember about the functional components. So and remember that vagus nerve comes out along with accessory and glossopharyngeal through the jugular foramen, and there begins the internal jugular vein, and it has two ganglion, superior ganglion at the level of jugular foramen and infraganglion at the base of the skull outside. Okay, and it comes out as a rootlet, 10, around 10 rootlets. So I hope I have done justice to the class today. Okay. Have you understood nicely?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this whole yellow color vagus nerve, we completed with the vagus nerve, and you all study, and if you don't understand any part, you can tell me. Okay.